doing today. Forgive me if time and time again I say morning. Custom in the morning. We had a great time. We have some folks from Brampton supporting. Let me first of all bring greeting for my wife, Alicia, two daughters. Celine is on the projector soon. And my next daughter, Christine, is back in Shelburne, hopefully. Or maybe in some restaurant somewhere. This morning I want to share on God's workshop. How many of you this evening have started on God's workshop? How many of you have ever been to God's workshop? Good. I guess none of you, because you're not sure what I'm going to share about. So by the time I'm finished with this message, we will all understand it. But when God is ready to use a man, to develop him, he approaches it in the strangest of ways. As we go through the scripture, we see Moses. God handpicked a man by the name of Moses, sends him to the backside of the desert, and retrains him. Moses was well learned in politics. He was well learned in management. But he was not learned in obedience and humility. And so God needed Moses to learn how to hear and understand his voice. And what does God do? He sends him to see about sheep. Strange. Because God wanted to retrain him. He takes Abraham and pulls him away from his family. He pulls him away from his people. He pulls him away from his country. And he separates him simply to stretch his fate. And how does God do that? He didn't take him to a Bible school. He sends him out and asks him to give up what was most important to him. To give up his son. You see, anything that becomes more important to us than God becomes a god. And so Abraham had to give up his only son, and that was God's way of stretching his fate. When God wants to use a man, he handpicks them out, and he takes the disciples, fishermen, and all they knew about was how to catch fish. And God says, I'm going to train you how to become fishers of men. When God is ready to use a man, he approaches it in the strangest of ways. He finds that man. He cleans him up. And then he uses him. But God's selection is based on faithfulness. You see, your shortcomings, your achievements, your abilities and inabilities, it does not influence God. God simply looks at your faithfulness and selects you to use you. And God chooses whom he made. I thank God that's the way he chooses, because when God looked down and he saw me, there were so much challenges in my own life. There was so much shortcoming in my own life. But in spite of those, God decided that he wanted to use this man. Could I share with you this evening? By the age of 10, 11, maybe 12 years, I was already preaching the gospel. Preaching is something that is natural to me. It's simple to me. I was preaching the gospel. We would gather in our street, some of the young people. In those days, we did not have iPads and tablets and whatnot. Our games was going out into the streets and playing. And we would gather to have service right through every single day during the summer holiday. We would have service together. And we would have some of the young people gathering together. And I was the preacher. I used to preach the word. I wasn't sure if I was preaching it right. I maybe didn't learn all the logistics of how to structure a sermon. But I was preaching the word. And we had an exciting time. We had church. strange enough, at the age of 12, 13, the Holy Ghost was moving in our midst. There were young people that were speaking in tongues. At the age of 18, God called me out to Bible school, and I went into Bible school and graduated. And I wasn't sure what God was going to do with me, because there were so many mistakes I made in my life. But God was walking with me. God was walking with me. And then God decided that He was going to call me out for ministry. 11 years back, I worked closely with my pastor. I was just working with him. I was preaching and ministering God's word. And I was faithful in all that I was doing. And then one day a minister came up with a bright idea, and he called me out and he says, God is ready to use you. You need to get into ministry. And I looked at him and I said, yes, right. I had everything going for me. I had a good job. I had a beautiful wife. Still do. I had my own house. I had everything going for me. Why would I want to go and serve people? I had people working under me. I am in a managerial position. I said, that's not for me. I work with a pastor, and I see how he give his life for people, and I see how he worked hard with people, and I never appreciated it, and I never wanted to be in pastoring. I ran away from it. For years I would run away from it, but God was ready to use a man. And so we were in anniversary service, and a minister was ministering it, and he called me out of the congregation. He brought me in the front and he said, you're being stubborn. God has called you out for ministry and you need to get into ministry. And I looked at him and I said, you can say what you want. I am not going into pastoring. And I thought it would be a good idea to be an evangelist. You know, I can preach and I can just go. But after that, hearing that word, I was one of the most miserable young men. I couldn't sleep. I just couldn't enjoy life, and everything that I had became insignificant. It was no longer important. And I went to God and I said, God, if I am going into ministry, you need to put every single thing in place. And some of you may not like the way that I talked to God. I talked to God. I said, I'm not going into ministry unless you put it into place. And God spoke with me just as I'm speaking with you today and said, it's not going to be about you, it's going to be about me. And so we came up with the ministry, because God gave us the name for the ministry, Thy Will Ministry, because it's not about us, it's about God. And God sent 12 men when we started the ministry, who were contractors and electricians. And we started the ministry with 12 men, and in 9 months we completed our building debt free. People were amazed. And God started to work, and I kept listening to the voice of God. And for the past 11 years I've seen God work. It was not just 11 simple, easy years, but God has kicked me through His workshop. He found me, and God wants to find you this morning. Sometimes we become so preoccupied in our daily living. But God simply wants to pull you out and send you into His workshop so that He can produce out of you a masterpiece. And so what does He do? I want to take your attention and take you down to the silversmith. Because he takes Malachi in Malachi chapter 3, verse 3. And he says, he will sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver. The first thing that God does is that He takes us through the process of refining. He takes us through the process of refining. The story is told of a reporter who wanted to understand the work of the silversmith. So she goes down to his workshop, and she looks at him as he's at work. And the silversmith sits there, and he takes the silver and he holds it over the fire. And as he holds it over the fire, his eye eyes is kept fixed on it, and he's keeping the silver over the fire, and he's allowing it to be burnt. And she looked at him, and she says, how do you know when the silver is at its purest? How do you know when the silver is finished? How do you know when it is perfect for you to pull it out of the fire? And he replied, when you see yourself in it. I'm here to tell you this morning that when God takes you through the fire, it's not to burn you out, but when God takes you through the fire, it's to purify you and to make you more valuable. When God takes you through the fire experience, when God takes you through those challenging experiences, when God takes you through and he holds you over the fire, it's because he wants to purify you so that you can be a good reflection of who he is. People will see Jesus in you. Don't run away from the fire experiences. Don't run away from the refining. God is simply taking you through because he wants to reflect himself through you. People will only see Jesus when they see you. And so in order for us to represent God for who he is, it is imperative that he must take us through the fire experiences. And the fire experiences is not easy sometimes. It can become very heated. Sometimes we feel like coming out. Sometimes we feel like giving up. Sometimes we feel God's not worth it. Why am I going through this? Why do I have to go through this? But God holds us there. He holds us there. And he doesn't leave us. His eyes is fixed on us because he knows the perfect time. He knows when enough is enough. And I thank God that his eyes is always on us. The songwriter says his eyes is like a sparrow. He just keeps fixed on us. The fire don't burn you out. The fire stirs you up. The fire makes you into a better person this evening. When God is ready to use a man, he takes him to the silversmith. He takes him through the process of refining. When God is ready to use a man, he takes him to the potter's house. The process of remolding this evening. Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 1 to 6. God calls to Jeremiah and he says, I want you to go down to the potter's house and there you will hear my word. And as Jeremiah goes on to the potter's house, he sees the potter. He's working on the wheel. He has the clay in his hands. And he takes the clay and he massages it. He takes the clay and he beats at it. He takes the clay and he continues to maneuver the clay. And he rotates the clay. And he's massaging the clay because he's trying to remove all the air pockets from that clay. Because the potter knows that if he creates a vessel and there is air pockets in that clay, then the vessel will become mad, the vessel will have imperfection, the vessel will not be able to do what it was supposed to do. And so he takes time to massage that clay and bring the clay into a workable point. And I can tell you this evening that that massaging, that beating, that working in God's hand, sometimes it's not easy. But it is possible that when he works it, what makes it very difficult is when the clay decides it wants to do its own thing. But the clay becomes workable in the potter's hand when it is submissive to the potter. And so we have to learn that we must become submissive in God's hand. We must become obedient in God's hand. We must allow God to massage us. We must allow God to maneuver us. We must allow God to rotate us. And then he gently placed the clay on the wheel, as it seems good to the potter. Because for many of us, we want to tell God the kind of vessel that we would like to be. We want to tell God, this is the way that I want life to be. So many times ministers will call and they will ask, do you want to go into the mission field? And missionary is not my thing. And they will go into the interior of Guyana and all these places, and I will say, okay, when you're doing mission in America, I will go. If you're doing mission work in Canada, I will go. But God wants, we need to be submissive. The gentleness of the potter's hand is felt when the clay becomes submissive. We must understand that the potter only have good intention. He wants to produce a vessel that is fit for use. He wants to produce a vessel that is perfect. He wants to produce a vessel that is precise, so he's very meticulous in the way he maneuvers the clay. And he works with the clay because he knows the end result. He pictures it in his mind. He knows what he wants to create it. So in his hand it's just clay. But he knows in his mind that I'm going to produce a vessel that is going to be perfect, that is going to be useful. And so you may see yourself just as being that clay today. You may see yourself as being nothing. You may see yourself as being insignificant. But if you place yourself in the potter's hand, he will create a vessel that can be used this evening. He knows. He knows. And so he's about to create. And the whole process of remolding takes place when the potter begins to place his hand around that clay. And he maneuvers the clay and he rotates it on the wheel. And he's shaping it into the kind of vessel that he wants it to be. And that's what God does in our lives. And every day as we go, every challenges, every situation, every circumstances that we face, we learn to overcome them. It's God's way of molding and shaping us and maneuvering us and going into the way that he wants us to become. He has created a very perfect and valuable vessel today. Don't shy away from the experiences. Don't try to jump off the potter's wheel. Just be submissive. Say, God, here am I, clay in your hands. And God, I am ready to be created as a vessel. Remold me today. Reshape me today. Do, God, as you will in my life. I am just going to be submissive to what you want me to be. When God wants to use a man, he takes him to the potter's house because he wants to remold him. He wants to remold him. When God wants to use a man, he takes him to the blacksmith's. And in the blacksmith's shop is the place of reshaping. A process of reshaping. Isaiah chapter 44 and verse 12 tells us, now the smith with the tongs both work it in the coals and fashion it with the hammer. As we go into the blacksmith shop, we see a different experience. The blacksmith takes a piece of metal and he placed it on the hot coals. And he placed the metal on the hot coals because he wants to bring the metal to a flexible point. He cannot produce a weapon. He cannot produce a weapon unless the metal comes to a place where it can be beaten. And so when the metal comes into a flexible point, he then takes the hammer and he begins to beat that metal. And every strike that he makes on that metal is that he can shape the metal into a weapon that can be used. I'm sure many of us can identify with the fact when we took a beating from God. When your good is not good enough. When you're prayed about a situation and rather than it becoming better, it just got worse. When you think that it was all over and God, I've gone through the process, it started all over again. My preach it to somebody this evening. When you tell God, I've loved and I've given everything that is within me, God came and He says, you just need to love a little more. When you say, God, I've given my all, what more can I give? And God says, you just need to go a little more distance. You just need to give a little more. And He says, God, what else can I give? And God says, you need to give a little more. The beating process, when God beats upon our lives and it feels to the point where we want to give up on God, it is just God's way of producing a weapon so that He can use it in His army. A good weapon is not made overnight. An untrained soldier is not sent in great wars. It is said that great ships are meant for deep waters. If you want to be a good soldier, if you want to be a good weapon, then you have to go through that process of reshaping today. You have to go through the process of being beaten over and over and over and over again. Now, 11 years of ministry, sometimes as a pastor, you feel that there is no much more you can give. Sometimes as a pastor, you feel that you have loved the people with all the love that you have. And it does not reciprocate. It does not come back to you as a pastor. But you need to love them anyway. You need to give anyway. And sometimes you feel that this is just not a Sunday morning for you. And you need to rise up and you need to preach the word as God wants you to preach the word. And you wonder, where is God in all of this? And sometimes you preach the word and you say, God, where is your presence? Where is your anointing? And it seems like you are taking so much beating for God. And you need to realize deep within that God is producing a weapon out of you. David would encourage himself in the Lord because sometimes it seems nobody else to encourage you. And you look for a good word and you look for somebody to bring a word of prophecy. God, if only you can give me a clear sign of what you want. And there is no clear signs. There is no open doors. And you're standing alone. And you're walking it alone. And it's God's put. It seems like God is just putting the pressure. Putting the pressure on you. You need to understand that He's producing a masterpiece. Amen. He wants you to become a weapon in His hand. And so you need to endure the hammering. You need to endure the cold. And when you think that the hammering is all over, the blacksmith looks at the weapon and he ensures that it is well balanced. He ensures that it can be maneuvered properly. And if it's not, he puts it back onto the coal and he takes it out and he begins to beat it again and beat it again until there is a sharpened edge. Because without a sharpened edge, you will not be able to cut. And so he wants you to be a cutting edge person. And he can only do that when he begins to hammer at your life. When he begins to beat at your life. God wants to produce the best out of you this evening. And He begins by doing that, by selecting a man, taking him into the workshop, taking him through the process of refining, the process of remolding, the process of reshaping. And when he is completing the process, he has produced a mighty weapon, a beautiful vessel, a pure silver. He has good intention, and his intention is for our benefit. We don't see tomorrow, next week, next year, but God sees, and God knows. We understand our future from our past because we look back at our past and we see where God has taken us from. And we see what we have gone through. And all that we have gone through over the years, it did not last a lifetime. God had walked us through it. And the experiences that we have had has made us stronger, has made us braver, has raised our faith and stirred up our anointing. And God will continue to use the experiences of our life to bring us to the place where He wants us to be. And if we haven't learned from it, He will take us through the process again and again and again until He produces the person that He wants. Not what we want, what He wants. And so we need to understand that clearly this evening. That as we go through the process, don't avoid it. As you go through it, God is going to go through it with you. Maybe this evening you are in the potter's wheel. Maybe this evening you are in a blacksmith coal or a silversmith furnace. Don't jump off, because God is about to produce a masterpiece. Are you hearing? God is about to produce a masterpiece. I was young in ministry, recently got married, and we did not have it all. I was faithful to God. It seems like I was doing everything right before God. I would work a night shift, wait the entire night, but make sure I'm there on Sunday morning for service. And sometimes on a Saturday night, my pastor would call and he would say, could you preach that Sunday morning? And I would not say, Pastor, I've waited all night. I will go out there and I will preach the word. And I've learned always to have a message prepared and waiting. Because he would call late on Saturday night and says, could you preach on Sunday morning? And I never knew what it is to say no. No was not in my vocabulary. I'm a very good friend of mine, and he would often look at me and he says, you need to learn to say no. He says, they will kill you. You need to learn to say no. I never knew what it is to say no. But in one hand, I would look at myself being faithful to God and doing everything right. And in the next hand, I would look at my family life, because we did not have the best of home. When myself and my wife married, you were afraid, we were ashamed to invite people to come into our home, because if you walk in the flooring, you can go straight through. We would buy the cheapest vinyl and cover up all the floor, because there were holes on the floor. I would go to work and I would sit in my job and I would cry before God, because I would look at my salary, and then we had our first daughter, and I would say, God, this does not make sense. This cannot add up. How is this going to maintain a family? You know, when you were young and you get involved in a relationship, they say love will help you through. I love my wife, it wasn't helping. I had good friends who would come and help me pay my electric bill, because they would not cut my electricity. I know what it is to go through God's workshop. I know what it is to have my faith stretched before God and trust Him when there seems to be no way, just being faithful, walking with God. But I held on to Jesus. I was faithful to Him. It didn't make sense for me to serve God, because it seemed like He was not acting on my behalf, but I held on to God. People could have looked at me and said, are you a Christian? Is your God not working for you? But I held on to God. I cried day after day after day before God. I know what it is to trust God for my need. I was faithful and paid my tithes with the little that I had and sowed it into God's kingdom. And I saw God move me from where I was to where I am today in 10 years, influencing the current, the gospel of Jesus Christ. I've saw God move me from a small community that was insignificant, raise us up into a church that is moving leaps and bounds and traveling beyond the doors of Trinidad and preaching the gospel of Jesus. I've seen God's anointing and power works on my behalf. And when I come into a service, I know that God's presence is there. And I serve Him faithfully. And I trust Him before I leave that service that He's going to act on our behalf. I know the God that I serve. Amen. So when I speak about Jesus, I speak about Him in confidence. Because I look back at the pastor and I can tell you today that God will take you through. Amen. He don't give up on His children. He don't give you more than what you can bear. He walks with you every mile of the way. And no matter what the challenges you are going through this evening, God will see you through. That's why the psalmist David says, yea, do I walk through the shadows and the valleys of death. His rod and his staff, they comfort me. He will take you to the workshop. Don't try to avoid it. Because He wants to produce the best out of you. Wherever you may be positioned this evening, we want to pray and perhaps walk with you. Many of you may say, Pastor, I can identify with what you are saying today because I'm in the potter's wheel. I can identify with what you are saying this evening because I am in the blacksmith's, the silversmith's fire. I'm in the blacksmith's coal. I'm going through that process of refining. I'm going through that process of rebuilding. I'm going through that process of reshaping. And it's not easy, it's hard. I'm not here to tell you it's easy. I'm here to tell you it's hard. But I'm here to tell you it's worth it all. It's worth it all. He has good intention. He wants to produce the best. You may feel that you are at your best, but you are not at your best yet. God is constantly working with you. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed this evening, right where you are. If you would say, Pastor, I don't want to come out of public. I don't want to come out the blacksmith, the coal, the silversmith fire. I need to go through the process. I know the process is necessary. It's hard, but it's necessary. But I also know that God's grace is going to see you through. Could you pray with me this evening? I can identify with you. And right where you are, I want to pray with you. I'm going to ask you, if you're going through the process, if you can identify with what we have preached this evening, stand right where you are and we're going to pray. Right where you are. You say, I know, I've been through it, I know what it is, I'm going through some situation, I know what you're talking about, Pastor. Could you just remember me in a few words of prayer? If somebody would have stepped up and said, Brother, I want to pray with you because I know what you're going through. That would have made such a difference. If somebody could have just come and walk with me and hold my hand and say, I know what you're going through. I would have a word of prayer with you. That would have made so much difference. Nobody did. But today we want to pray with you. I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you today. Whatever you're going through, God has your best interest at heart. He's going to see you through this evening. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.